opinions expressed on the following program are strictly those of the host and participants and do not reflect the views of Taunton Community Access and Media, Inc., its management, or directors. Hi, welcome to Charlie Flannery Presents. I'm your host, Charlie Flannery. And today, it gives me great pleasure to present Miss Dana Wine. Dana.
Hey, Charlie. Thanks for having me on the show.
Yeah, thank you for coming to Charlie Flannery Presents. You were supposed to be bringing another guest with you, Mr. Billy V. Vigen.
Yeah. He's usually
very prompt.
Billy? Yeah, he's usually very prompt. Actually, he is very prompt. I'm usually in trouble for not being prompt.
Uh-huh.
He'll call me and he'll be early, and he's usually saying, Dana, it is your responsibility to be here 15 minutes early. So, you know, we're going to bust on him for this one.
He must be making money.
Yeah.
It must involve money.
I'm guessing.
You know, either somebody that or paid him more than we offered.
Getting a really good picture coverage, you know. Uh-huh. He might be getting a good photo shoot.
Uh-huh. So, when I first met you, it was through Billy and my friendship with not only him, but Bobby Kenny.
Right, right.
By the way, we get $5 every time we do a shout out to someone like Bobby Kenny.
I get $5? Shout out
Billy
to Bobby!
And you know, and the person that made that top, let me see what it says.
It's this is Polly Papalicio, and he's part of Big Daddy's Cool Stuff down in Lebanon, Connecticut. Check them out. Polly is actually our artist for the fedoras.
Oh, nice.
So
nice.
I just want to say that I had this cute little red sundress on that looked really good on me. Red looks great on me, and I'm stuck in this to advertise Polly. So make sure that we check out Polly Papalicio. He's on my Facebook page, too.
So you had quite a gathering of talent on the fedoras project, right? Now, and at one time, when I first met you, you were Dana Wine Howard.
Correct. I was.
What the heck happened to Howard?
The Fedora's Web Mob Series. I had been married for, you know, I mean, I'm 25, but I've been married for like 25 years. And
a teenage bride.
And so, you know, there are many issues, obviously. One thing doesn't completely dismantle a marriage, but I will say that the fedoras, that did not help. It was a very time-consuming project. It was a project that I was very, very passionate about. I didn't really get the reciprocating excitement on the other end. And it was just a constant battle. My ex was, you know, you're always gone, you're always taking off, you're always working.
Hold on a second. This isn't Oprah. You know, I mean, I asked you a simple question.
Oh, you wanted to know if I was like, if there's, you know, any like good stuff
like,
going on behind the scenes?
Like, you know, I got divorced. Okay, good.
Okay, I got divorced.
Like, he didn't understand me.
Hey, is that a beer right there? Pass that over so we can drink in my wallet.
You know,
Soros.
If you had shown up earlier, you know, but oh my God. Oh,
hey, you asked.
Okay, so now it's.
So let's just sum it up.
You're
I'm
back
divorced.
To your maiden name.
I'm back to my maiden
and
name.
And I love Dana Wine. It has a great
name. Thank you. It does sound like an actor's name.
Yeah.
The funny thing is, that is my born, God-given name, or not really God, maybe parents, but I was almost named Candy Wine. I would probably not be an actress. I'd probably be a pole dancer, possibly a hooker right now.
But, you know, it's never too late.
It's never too late?
You know,
I bet I can make more money than I could acting. Might want to think about this.
You know, it career changes. You know, there was a time when, you know, you picked a career path and you were on it for the next 40, 50 years of your life.
Yeah,
today,
how dull.
You know, every 5 or 6 months, sometimes, you know, we're adapting new skills. Or
5 or 6 months for ADHD people like us. Other people, it's probably 5 or 6 years.
Yeah, yeah. But you're, now, how, talking about the fedoras, where the heck is Billy? I mean, you know, I'm sorry we had to proceed without you, buddy, but, you know.
Well, I mean, I'm more entertaining than Billy is, let's face it.
Yeah. We would have had to put him over here somewhere, you know what I mean?
Hey, Billy, go in that corner over there.
No.
His voice would project. No, Billy's a great guy. We love to pick on Billy, but Billy's a great guy.
What was the genesis, the beginning of Fedoras?
Originally, I had written this script beginning to end. It was a pretty tight script. And I guess I had just recently gotten on Facebook, and Billy V. Vugent, he found me, and he started rating me, and he said, hey, let's meet up. So we went out to Cindy's Diner out in Rhode Island, which is like one of my favorite places. And we met up, and he said, I want to be on this movie. And I was like, we don't have a budget. Like, basically, my friends and I were putting this together for fun. Uh-huh. If 25 people saw us on YouTube, we're going to be happy, and we're, you know, and that call it a day. So Billy's like, doesn't matter. I want to be on it. I'm not worried about it. You know, we'll figure it out. So I go home and I rewrite the script and I put in Nino Ponticello, which is his character. And then I would say about a week later, he calls me and he says, my friend Bobby Kenny wants to be in it. And I'm like, okay. And so he's like, maybe he could be another crime boss. So I go back home and I rewrite it again and I put Bobby in there. And then we start filming it, and partway into filming, Billy says, let's make it a web mob series. So I go home and I start rewriting again. And at that point, Billy says, oh, I'm starting to sound like a soap opera. Oh, see that? You caught me on that in the beginning of this interview. So he's like, we got to get another writer in. We got to get a guy's perspective. So we bring in another writer. And John Fiore. And so we...
That's $5. $5, John. You give a shout out to John K. Fiore. That's 10.
So we get the Fedoras thing going, and we begin with the episodes there, and you know, it was very patchwork quilted as we went along, and we were bringing in more people and more actors and more photographers and cinematographers, and
you were shooting this primarily weekends down in Connecticut.
We were shooting it, actually, another shout out for $5. My friend Barbara King has this gorgeous, gorgeous it's like a mini mansion. It was built recently, but it's designed very 1930s, and I think that's what inspired me to write this. So she loves it. She's like, film at my house, I love it. So she would help me, she would help with the food, she would open up our house, she would help with props, she was great with costuming. So most of it was filmed at her house. Part of it was at the Italian Club, the Italian Social Club in Rockville.
Are you Italian?
I'm not at all. I am a mutt, but I don't have to my knowledge. You know, there were lucid affairs that happened all the time back in the day. I could be, but to my knowledge, I'm not.
I mean, you know, you were starting to sound like a dream. You know, you were
How about
divorced.
A Pollock? You like Pollock?
You were divorced. You liked eating at a cheap diner. You were a cheap date. If you had only been Italian, you know what I mean? There could have been hope. You know, there's still hope.
There could be, you
there's
know.
Still hope, yes. But I'm sorry, getting back to your story.
So we had filmed there, and then this other couple... the Testones, Michael and Megan, opened up their home. They have a real speakeasy from the 1930s in the basement of their home in West Hartford, this beautiful house.
Is this classified information? Are they going to be being raided now?
They might be.
This is being broadcast
$5 for the
world. Live to the world, yeah. $10 for a fake name.
Well has run dry. There's no more alcohol. Yeah. But it was great. So they opened up their home to us, and we didn't even know them. So the Hartford Courant came out and took pictures and did this write-up. And they were great. They're a great couple. They jumped in. Mike took a part as the bartender, and Meg was a prostitute. She was a great sport. She jumped right in there as a hooker. So basically,
makes you wonder. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, kind of makes you wonder. You know, she's pretty cute, guys. She's pretty cute, but I'm telling you where she lives, so we got to be careful. But I think what was so great is so many people brought so much to the table with no budget. And I, you know, are there flaws? Yeah, there's flaws. I mean, I could be the first to admit that. But I feel like for what we started with, what our goal was, and what it had become, it's truly amazing.
What have you captured on film to date?
To date, in terms of bloopers or the real thing?
No, in terms of the real thing. Have you captured like an hour of... or a couple of 10-minute episodes? What have you gotten in the can, so to speak?
So far, our first episode came out, which is a combination of the first and the second episode combined. So it's longer than what the rest of the episodes will be. And then we're I believe up to episode 6. We are filmed up that far in advance, and the rest will be probably between 7 to 10 minute long episodes, because obviously with YouTube, to keep anyone's attention span longer than that is yeah. difficult. And we actually have these numbers that my friend J.R. Hepburn had helped. He had no part of you know, the YouTube, but he went in and did the research, and he sends me a picture, and he's like, this is how long people are watching it, Dana. I told you not to go past 7 minutes.
We've been doing this for 10 minutes, and at least 60% of the audience is already tuned out.
They're gone.
Thanks for tuning in.
Maybe you could flash them, do something exciting. That
please, you know, we'll lose another 20% like that, you know. Billy, I can't believe the guy is always so talented.
When he comes in, that's when the audience will come back.
So, you have a 10-minute episode.
Well, there is 8 total. I believe that were filmed approximately to, I think it's episode 6 right now. So we put out the first 2 combined. We still have a little edits and fix-ups for the next one that's coming out that we have to reshoot. Mm-hmm. A lot of reshoots. And I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that it was never meant to be as big as it was, and we didn't have a budget. So we definitely have had several reshoots.
And there's a learning on the fly curve. When there's no check to write with.
Yes.
You know?
That and you know, there, because I guess the original plan was, you know, plan A, and we didn't expect all of these other things to happen. It's almost like, you know how you do a business plan. I mean, when you're doing film, you sort of have a business plan. This person's going to do this. This person's going to do that. And it didn't work out that way, because it was really just supposed to be a 20-minute YouTube clip. We're going to break it up in 4 and air it. And then it just went kind of wild.
Well, one thing I've been doing lately is I've been working on a storyline that Bobby Kenny and I developed over a year ago. We started laying the groundwork for it, called Wilson's Limo. And what we've been doing is about once every 4 to 6 weeks, we'll shoot a 3 to 4 minute scene.
That's a great idea.
And then whatever actors were part of that scene will stay on for almost like the actor's studio, and we'll kind of fill in the narrative about our characters and things like that. And I don't have any of that available to watch, but I do have a tape that Bobby Kenny was kind enough to send along, and it contains a lot of shots from Fedoras.
Okay.
Now, if we can ask Mr. Zach Swing, technician extraordinaire, to put it up there on the monitor, we might be able to take a look. Zach, can you run that for us, honey?
You owe me 5 large, and I want my money.
3, 1, 2, 3.
Chile! Aha,
I got it.
3 and 2.
No, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
No,
that was down.
That wasn't down.
Down, it was up.
It was up. That's up.
Hey, check that out.
Over there.
What? Cougar. Why? Because of my loyalty.
How did we both miss him? It's friggin' embarrassing.
I emptied my piece.
I threw my gun at and missed.
The only reason I haven't choked the life out of you yet is because you're my sister's kid.
Hey, baby. What you doing?
Huh? What are you talking about? What? Why are you crying? Keep your company.
Well, his pop and mine used to make these nickel and dime bets. They put us in this... We were just babies, huh? They put us in this big tin wash tub. They throw it a piece of chew in the back of your candy and watch us fight over it.
Who won?
My mother.
I wish I could see your faces. Charlie, pause the tape.
We'll be right back.
That was great. Huh? That was great.
I'm telling you, it was like
great. Good job.
Good stuff.
I can't wait to see these.
He's a blast to work
with.
He is. You know?
He is. Bobby is a fun guy. He is your typical Irish, Italian. You know, just you go there and he's fun. He is a ball of laughs.
We actually had a friend of ours who's involved with the Wilson's Limo Show.
Uh-huh.
We aired that clip during the actor's studio portion. And it was actually a longer version. I think the original version was like over 3 minutes.
Okay.
And it had a lot of naughty words.
Like the fedoras.
You know.
We've been slapped on that one before.
We hear on public access, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Violence is okay. You know what I mean?
Sex is always welcome.
Sex, you know, if done in the other room. But, you know, definitely naughty words are out. So Alex Cash went in and edited down a nice 2 minute slice of Bobby's work. The pacing was great. And a lot of that stuff was from fedoras.
Right, right. Yes. And we had to edit a lot of that out, right? I'm sure Alexander was very busy with
them. It was actually a nice job. It was a seamless thing. There were just a couple of, you know, one or two naughties, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. They just had to be cleaned up. And it.
What's mafia? Come on. They're bad boys. Everybody likes a bad boy, right?
Well, you know, it's funny because this, the entire 3 minute segment was broken up to almost like half and half where Bobby was playing a gnarly guy and kind of a funny mobster guy, you know,
yep.
He would use his missing fingers.
Oh, he did that on set. He is.
Yeah, you know. We used that in a Wilson's Limo thing, and that was in that clip there, you know,
yep.
We just saw, you know. What was the name of the actor he did that with? A well-known guy. He was great. It wasn't Bob De Niro, I know that, you know.
But, and I remember him telling me on set, and I can't think of it either. But I know on fedoras, he'd, you know, there's that one scene where he's like, you've got 2 weeks, 2 weeks. And he has this little Boston accent. He's like, and he'd put up his finger. And he's like, you've got 2 weeks, one and a half.
He's something. He's a lot of fun to work with.
He is a lot of fun.
I tell you, if you become a friend of that guy, you got a friend for life. He's mm-hmm. a real stand-up guy. And, you know, it's those are few and far between.
Yes, they are.
In the world in general, and especially in business.
Oh, yeah.
Business, regardless of what it is, you know?
And I'll say, I mean, what a trooper for him and Billy Vigent also, because the travel, driving all the way down here. Jimmy, I'm not even going to attempt to say his last name. It's Greek. Papalogos. I'm terrible with names. But we had several. I just call him Jimmy Paps. Jimmy Paps.
Jimmy Paps, right.
And they would come down from Boston. And, you know, I mean, it was a long haul for them to come.
Papalogos.
Thank you. I'm so bad at saying these
names.
Five bucks. I was bad enough with Papalizio. I get them confused. But so they were great. They, you know, good sports. We had great people, I have to say.
And you did it on a much smaller budget.
You know, oh, yeah.
Pizza and beer, basically, you know?
yeah, it was, we were very fortunate. And it's kind of funny because a lot of people will always joke with me about that. They're like, if we get Dane on set, we know we can get something for nothing.
Well, one thing I found is everything takes longer, like Billy Vigent's arrival. Everything takes longer than one might expect, you know? And I swear it was... It's got to be close to a year ago that I had Billy V.
Yes.
And Bobby Kenny on my show.
Yep, I remember that.
To discuss the fedoras.
I do remember that.
And, you know, we played what a trailer or mm-hmm. whatever was in existence, you know what I mean?
Yep.
But it seemed at that time that, you know, something was going to be happening imminently.
Yes.
And it's just, you don't realize until you get behind the scenes, you know what I mean? If you
what
have
a
multi-million dollar budget, things happen imminently.
Oh, yeah,
you know
absolutely.
What I mean? If you
absolutely.
Don't.
And we were fortunate. Jimmy Mancini, who plays Patrick McKinney, he's a musician. So the music that you hear in the trailer, that's his music. So I mean, we were so fortunate in so many ways, you know, because we have such multi talent. We had Paulie doing all the artwork, so that was great. And definitely have to say hats off to my editor, Joel Buska, because
he did a great job.
He did a great job, yeah. And he had, you know, he had patchwork quilt pieces to work with, because when we first started, he was not part of it in the beginning. And he's outstanding. He has a great eye for knowing how to set up a scene. And I'm over here juggling, you know, because it got bigger than it was supposed to. So I'm juggling acting, directing, writing. And he's, you know, when he came in, he had some clips that needed a lot of work. And he was able to work with them. And I know he's been stressed. And Joel and I, it's great, because we can have this blowout. And it seems like we're never going to talk again. And then in a week, we're like, yeah, okay, you know, sorry about that. You know, and then we're back on, so.
My hat is off to anybody that knows how to edit at all.
Oh, it's
but,
so much
work. But, I mean,
some people,
it's really an art form.
It really is.
You know, did you notice that? An art.
An art form.
An art
I am
form,
in the Massachusetts, know? Boston area. I gotta tell you a story.
You're closest to New York, aren't you?
I am closer to New York. Well, I'm probably right in the... I think I'm really right in the middle. I can go either way. Schizophrenic.
You know, that's what I'm saying, you know? I mean, you're either with us... or it's like President George W. Bush said. You're either with us or you're against us.
You're against us. And I'm always do I want to wear the Yankee shirt or the Boston shirt?
I bet. All right? I'll bet you a beer. You like the Yankees, don't you?
Oh, come on. I'm in Massachusetts. You're killing me. You're going to kill me in this market.
Come on. You'll never work this town again unless
Boston. Absolutely Boston.
Okay, there you go. There you go. Look, she's, ladies and gentlemen, she's wearing red socks. I will testify.
Got my red socks.
They can't see any of that, you know. But
got my red socks tattoo back here. But you know, this is a family show. I can't show you that stuff.
Yeah, please. You know, the dads don't mind, but the moms call them complaining like crazy. You know. So you also brought a little something more recent that you've been working on. Would you like me to have Master Zach?
Master Zach, cue that up for us,
and we can take a quick looky-poo with that.
Okay, let's see, take a quick looky-poo with that.
Okay, Zach, can you do me a favor and cue up this recent thing that Dana brought in for us?
We need to talk. I need you.
Oh, now you need me? You know what? You boys have been nixing my opportunity for months. For bigger clubs, bigger shows, now all of a sudden you need me? Why do you owe him so much money?
Forget about it. It's not your concern.
It is my concern because—
I just said it's not your concern!
Let me tell me what you know about the heist.
I don't know nothing.
Come on. Here's the main man.
Well, exactly why I shouldn't be here doing this with you.
You know what I think? I think Patrick did his own heist. I think he took his own money. I think he's gonna let Sal take the fall for it.
Watch your mouth. Talk doesn't get you killed, crazy thing.
Think about it, Lenny. He owes every crime boss from New York to Boston. It's a liability. It's a liability to you, to me. You need to get away from him.
Stop talking that nonsense. Get dressed. You know Patrick's gonna be home soon. He finds us here, kill us both. Get yourself together. Meet you downstairs.
You know what? 2 years ago, you'd have been like, Antonia, oh, why don't you go down to Harry's?
This is not 2 years ago!
He hasn't returned my calls.
Do you think that he's
scared? I'm not sure. I'm sure one of my guys would have called me by now. This may change things. Might just change everything.
Once again.
I have lots of questions about my character.
I'm surprised you didn't hold out for more money when I tried to get you on
the
show.
Remember the candy
thing?
I think
that's what's tying up Billy V.
He's afraid I'm getting more money than he is.
Well, don't even mention that. You know, he didn't even know you were getting paid.
I get his half now. He didn't come.
He didn't even know you were getting paid.
Well, that's Antonia. See, Antonia knows how to get paid.
Everyone thinks this show is done for nothing. You know what I mean? It cost me about $2,000
to put free.
A typical
Nothing's
show
free.
On. You know what I mean? But
basically, my character is Antonia Castello. But the funny thing is, Billy Vigent, well, Nino Ponticello, always calls her Antonia rather than Antonia, which is great because everybody else is calling her Antonia, and he's like, Antonia. But my character is basically...
That's very authentic.
Yes.
Antonia.
Yes. Yeah. And leave it to Billy to do that. You know, he'll just, he puts a special stamp on everything.
He tries to pass for Italian. He's not. I think he's French, but he tries to pass.
I think he's French Italian.
Is he?
I think
really
he does
have
some. I think he does. Right. I think he does. I have to say, I'm not the Italian.
Let's hope.
I'm not the Italian, but
let's
I think
hope.
He is.
We can only hope. You know what I mean?
But my character is. I view her as a very feminist character for the 1930s. I mean, she sleeps with everybody, but she uses sex as power. And back in the 30s, that's really how a woman could have power. A single woman.
Things have changed so radically.
You're shocked.
Boy,
okay.
That was so last century.
Okay, maybe we just conceal it better now. I don't know. But anyway.
Did we men as a gender get smarter in the last century? I don't think so.
I'm going to agree with you on that one. I don't think so
much,
either.
No. You know what I mean?
But basically, she's working the system. I mean, she's Patrick's girl, and she knows that Patrick's not putting a ring on her. And in the 30s, I mean, you got a time limit as a woman, let's face it, you know? So she's already branching off. She's looking for the next thing, you know, the next best. So she loses Nino Ponticello. He has money. So basically, she's just kind of working the system. So... Yeah, my character gets around a little bit.
A woman can't have too many friends.
That's right. That's right.
You know?
They're just friends. God.
Yeah. Friends with,
and she gets rich off it.
Friends with money. I mean, benefits. I mean.
Friends with perks. They did that back in the 30s, too, you know.
I can't believe it. I can't believe it. Go ahead. Before we get bleeped
out. Do I have
out,
you all tongue-tied over this? Is
well, I was going to take it somewhere, but we can't go there.
Because
you know?
This is a family.
It's a children's show.
Yeah, there's children's show. We can't have swears, but we can't go there.
This comes on, we are 7:30 at night, Wednesday nights, and that's usually a blast. And then we air 11:30 in the morning on Saturday morning.
When the kids are watching cartoons.
And we're a good alternative to cartoons. Something like you with the T-shirt, the dads will love. They'll encourage the children to watch. You know what I mean? Then we're on at 6 o'clock Sunday night for the after church crowd.
The after church crowd.
Yeah.
We try to
cover a little bit of everyone. You know what I mean? And keep everyone happy. But
there is a church scene. There's a church scene that will be coming up later for those that are going to church.
It's not one of those. You didn't steal it from The Godfather.
I didn't steal anything from anything. Uh-huh. I don't steal.
So you say. Well, you know, I can't believe there's so many questions I still want to ask, but at the same time, we're starting to burn daylight. We're running out of time.
Running out of time. Boy, time goes fast when you're having fun.
Can I have you on one more time?
You can have me on one more time.
Yeah.
Sold.
And this time. Next time, Billy V doesn't get invited.
Yeah, no Billy. We'll have Bobby. Where's Bobby? We'll have Bobby instead.
I don't know. I like one-on-one. This could go places.
That's good.
Yeah, this could take off. Listen, I'd like to thank you all for tuning in today to Charlie Flannery Presents. And if you have an idea for a show, say you'd like to be a guest on here, send an email to charlieflannery@verizon.net. In the subject line, write "Be a guest." Give me a little bit of a breakdown of what you'd like to talk about, or maybe you'd like to work on a little funny bit or something, and we may have you here as a guest one day on Charlie Flannery Presents. Until then, Dana, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And everybody stay safe.
It was fun. Thank you.